Pleasure to take a call to debate the report of the Finance and Expenditure Committee's report into the Reserve Bank Financial Stability Statement from May of this year. Mr. Speaker, I, in drafting the comments I intend to make this evening, I had focused in the report on three sections of the committee's report, principally the comments relating to unemployment, taxation policies and the effect of GST. And finally, the effect on agriculture, or the importance of agriculture in our economy. But Mr. Cunliffe has just made a number of points, I think three of which need to be responded to. And before proceeding with my planned comments, I'd like to briefly comment on what some of the things that Mr. Cunliffe has said. Mr. Cunliffe has started by saying that the Reserve Bank, in its testimony, because he said these are the words of the Reserve Bank, these aren't the words of the government, the Reserve Bank focused on the need to rebalance the economy and in particular to defer funds away from consumption consumption that was funded by high levels of private sector debt and to put that money into one, paying off debt, but also deferring it into savings. And he said, look, this government doesn't have a plan, the Labor Party do. Well, the question has to actually be asked, why did we get in this situation in the first place? Why is the economy not balanced? Why do we need to rebalance the economy? And sir, the answer to that is very simply 9 years of mismanagement by the previous Labor government. The current government is having to address these problems because of the situation it found itself in when it took over the Treasury benches in November 2008. The next point that Mr. Cunliffe makes is that the government, on coming into power, reduced the subsidies on KiwiSaver from 4 cents in the dollar to 2 cents in the dollar. Well, why was that necessary? The reason, sir, that was necessary was that the government accounts were in such huge deficit, Mr. Speaker. They were in huge deficit. In essence, if you look at KiwiSaver, while it has a number of attractive features, which I personally support, what it essentially does is it subsidises people on higher incomes. It's a subsidisation on people on lower incomes who are not in a position to save, to subsidise with government funds, with taxpayer money, the savings of people in a much better position to save. And finally, Mr. Cunliffe, he said he criticised the government from backing away from pre-funding New Zealand superannuation. Well, once again, why is the government not setting aside funds into New Zealand superannuation? And very simply, as Mr. Cunliffe is very, very well aware, the government is in deficit. It's running a huge deficit, and that was a situation that was bequeathed to it by the Labor government. And what Mr. Cunliffe is suggesting is it doesn't matter whether we're $3-5 billion deficit every year, you would like us to go out and borrow some more money and invest it in through KiwiSaver, through with the New Zealand Superannuation Fund. And you know more than anyone else, Mr. Cunliffe, that the money that's been put into New Zealand Superannuation, the so-called Cullen Fund, is actually less than a dollar in the dollar at the beginning of this year. So despite the pre-funding, we've actually got less than a dollar in the dollar. Mr. Speaker, I'd now like to come to the comments I intended to make. And let me just start perhaps at the back of the report. There's comments here on unemployment, and it refers to the fact that the Governor informed us that the labour market is lagging the overall economic recovery in New Zealand. It's lagging. So we are not having higher levels of employment, rather. Unemployment is still hanging rather high. It's certainly over the 6% market. And we've just had this debate, this private member's bill, which was voted down this evening, on the proposal to cancel the 90-day trial. Well, Mr. Speaker, if you actually want to address the issues of unemployment, you actually need to do everything you can to incentivise employers to create jobs, to offer jobs, and to make it as easy as possible to get those jobs. And that is one of the great things about the 90-day trial, because it has enabled employers of companies of less than 20 people to go out and hire, knowing full well if they make a mistake, if the person that they employ doesn't work out, they don't have that ongoing liability. And so that 90-day trial is about to be extended to all employers in New Zealand. And sir, if there's anything that will make a move to address the higher levels of unemployment that the Governor is referring to in his testimony, it will be that. I thought it was particularly interesting that Manaia Mahuta, in speaking for that proposal, talked about the 60,000 unemployed, the 60,000 young people who are unemployed. Well, sir, why do we have such high levels of unemployed young people? And there's a very simple answer to that, Mr. Speaker. The previous government took out the youth rates. Previously, an employer could go out and they could hire a young person, a 17-year-old or an 18-year-old, and pay something less than the minimum wage. This is someone who previously, who didn't have full-time work experience, was able to go out there, and the employer had an incentive to take on a young person. And of course, the previous government took away, passed a law abolishing that youth wage. And so now, an employer who's faced with, say, two employees to hire, if he has a choice, say, between a 35-year-old, maybe a working a husband or a married lady, or a, you know, doesn't matter, man or wife, a family person, who may perhaps have a couple of young children's dependents, someone who has, you know, 10, 15 years of work experience, who's a proven track record. He offers, comes to offer that person a job. He can either choose between that person who's got work experience, who's got commitments, who has proven their reliability, or choosing a 16 or 17-year-old who hasn't got that same experience, hasn't shown that same track record of reliability. When faced with having to pay those two people exactly the same wage, the minimum wage, why wouldn't the employer go on to hire the mature person, the person with work experience, the person who has a track record of reliability? And sir, it's one of the great disgraces of this Parliament that when it had a chance to reinstitute youth wages earlier this year and support the private member's bill of my colleague, the Honourable Sir Roger Douglas, this Parliament, both Labor and National, chose to vote it down. And I think that's actually a disgrace. You'd expect that sort of thing of the Labor members. You certainly wouldn't have expected that from the National Party. And I think the National Party members, when they talk about youth unemployment, the answer lay in their own hands, and they actually had a chance to do something about that, sir, and they missed that opportunity. And tragically, sir, for those young people. Because as my colleague Sir Roger Douglas says, you've got a young person there, might be prepared to work for $9 or $10 an hour, and the parliamentarians in this House don't believe that young person should have that chance, will set them on the unemployment bed at about $160 a week. Mr. Speaker, I'd now like to refer to the section on agriculture. And it says here, the report of the committee, that agriculture makes up some 16% of total lending by New Zealand banks, and has said that as the cash flow position of farms has improved, the demand for credit has declined. And it talks here about the impact on the recent financial crisis on the agriculture industry. So once again, one of the great tragedies of this Parliament is we have proceeded with an emissions trading scheme on the 1st of July. We became the first country outside of Europe, the first country outside of Europe to have an emissions trading scheme. And in the words of the Honourable Nick Smith, Minister for Climate Change, the most comprehensive emissions trading scheme in the world. Those were his words on the 24th of September last year, repeated again on the third reading of that bill on the 24th of November. The most comprehensive scheme in the world. His words from Hansard, and he has the nerve to suggest that New Zealand's not leading on climate change. And what is the impact of the emissions trading scheme on farmers, sir? Well, the meat and wool, now beef and lamb New Zealand, have said the impact of the emissions trading scheme will be add some $3,900 a year to costs for the average dairy farmer. And so those costs don't come in 2015. They came in on the 1st of July this year. Dairy farmers are up for $3,900 from the 1st of July this year, sir. And do the farmers in Australia pay those costs, sir? No, they don't. To the farmers in Japan, Mr. Speaker, my time is coming to an end, but I simply would finish by saying if the Labor Party is concerned about the fact that we've had to reduce the subsidies on KiwiSaver, if they're concerned about the fact that we haven't been able to put the funds into the New Zealand Super Plan, the so-called Cullen Fund,
sorry to interrupt, the Honourable Member, his time has expired.